America was undergoing a great change during the 1960s. Rock and roll had acquired a British accent and now sang of peace and love and understanding. Elvis Presley seemed just a memory, a distant recollection of gyrating hips and a greased pompadour, an obsolete idol in a new world. But the king of rock and roll would no longer be passed by and drift gently into history. He would return to take back his throne. He would be reborn in black leather and challenge the world once again. And he would do it his way. Between 1960 and early 1968, Elvis made 24 films. But only performed twice to a live audience. Music had changed dramatically during his absence from the concert scene.
Time is on my side. Yes, it is.
The world had changed dramatically. But it was all about to change once again with one televised show, the 68 Comeback.
In my opinion, if you didn't mind my bluntness, but to me, he hadn't had a hit record in years. He wasn't making any movies, so what was really making him the superstar was just Colonel Parker and his publicity machine.
You know, up to that time, he'd been kind of languishing in these movies. They were getting a little increasingly goofier.
Bambi?
Yeah.
Hey, Bambi, don't have Bambi.
That's Elvis taking control of his career again. That's where he just had enough of the movies. You know, it's funny, television was always very important in his career.
But television was a way to either instantly the next day become the biggest star in the world or vice versa. You might do the television special and fall on your ass, and that would be the end of your career other than the memory of what you used to do. We set up a meeting and Elvis came out with, you know, the gang.
He walked down a hallway and he was like this caged panther, you know. He was surrounded by people, and yet I could see that he was like, he was wanting something to happen. He had gotten into this other Elvis. He had gone from one Elvis to another Elvis at this time, and he was so electric that, and so on, and so different than obviously what he was in the movies, that he had regained his stardom before he even did the special.
And we went into our office and we left everybody outside. I think it was just the Colonel, myself, Bones, Alan Bly, and Chris Beard, who wrote the special.
I thought, Elvis looks like he's got a great sense of humor, and even if he doesn't, I'm going to take my self in hand here and try and get to a place where I can discover if he's where I think he is, okay? So we were all introducing each other to each other, and I don't know whether Joe Esposito remembers this, but I said, Elvis, I really like your work. And then I turned to the Colonel and I said, Colonel, I like your work too, but more than that, I like your chicken, you see. That was a stupid joke. And of course, Elvis, how dare anybody talk to the Colonel like this? And he thought that was hysterical, so he started laughing. And of course, when he laughed, the guys that are around him laugh because that was their job, more or less. Next minute, I'm looking at him and he's looking at me and we're going, okay, we're going to do business here.
Colonel Parker came to Elvis with this idea of a night of personal space, TV special, Elvis's TV special. That changed a lot in Elvis's life and his career. I really think it made a big difference, but he was a little concerned. He was a little nervous. He had never done a TV special of his own. He had been on a couple of few shows, but never his TV special. And, you know, when NBC did the deal with you know, Colonel Parker. It was also including their throw and make a movie, too, which was Change of Habit.
I get a feeling there's a message here. Like maybe there's somebody else.
You could say that, yes.
Singer was the sponsor of the show. And, you know, we were these young Turks in those days. You know, Steve Binder, we were the people that had done all this angry television. And I don't know how we got to actually be chosen to do this, but I think Bob Finkel, who is a brilliant producer, said, I'm going to get Steve Binder because he's an angry young man. And then I'm going to get two guys who know comedy and know music and know production. I'll put all these people together, and I think it's going to work. And, of course, that's what happened. We wrote a killer special with killer stuff that gets played every year now, and it is the classic Elvis.
But there were still many obstacles that lay ahead. Elvis's manager, Colonel Tom Parker, and the director of the comeback special, Steve Binder, each wanted the show to go in different directions. It was time for Elvis to decide his own future.
Well, Colonel Parker had a lot of preconceived ideas, but my experience from the very beginning of my career to the present is that, you know, let creative people create and let business people do their business.
The only problem we had was with the Colonel. The Colonel had definitive ideas about what he wanted Elvis to do, which in many cases Elvis was not happy with, although he didn't fight him on a lot of them.
The Colonel wanted that to be a Christmas show.
He wanted Elvis to come out and sing some Christmas carols and then say goodnight, and that would be it. And he was lucky enough to have been hooked up with some very good producer, Steve Binder, and they really nailed the essence of Elvis. Elvis in front of a small audience, just being Elvis.
I just heard all of the talk of this is going to be a Christmas special. This is going to have 26 Christmas songs in it. And to be really honest with you, it never fazed me and it never entered my mind that that was what we were going to do.
Well, first of all, we had to get Elvis on our side. And of course, that came when we went by ourselves in a room with him and we all said to each other, we aren't going to do this United Nations shit. We're just not going to do it. So he says, well, I don't want to do that either. And we said, well, you want to do what we want to do? And we all said, yeah, we want to do rock and roll. We want to get a 32-piece orchestra. We want to get out there. We want to rock. Do Hound Dog, you know? So he says, oh, fantastic, yeah. So we went back in the room and the Colonel looked at all of us and he's going, something happened in there. I don't know what they were talking about, but this isn't the same Elvis that went in, because Elvis was like old, you know, like he was stoked. He was like, he was getting ready to go, aha, very loudly.
There was like a little war between Steve Binder and the Colonel and Elvis. Colonel wanted Elvis to end the show singing a Christmas song.
So he called me in one day and with Elvis, and the three of us were in this little water closet that he called an office. And he said, well, Elvis wants a Christmas song in the show. Don't you, Elvis? And Elvis sort of had his head down and his eyes lowered, and he said, yes, sir. And I said, fine, if Elvis wants a Christmas song in the show, we'll put a Christmas song in the show. And I won't use an expletive, but we walked out of the Colonel's office thinking it was resolved, and Elvis jabbed me in the ribs and he said, you know, blank him. We're not going to worry about that.
We didn't know more or less what we wanted to do, except we now knew that we had changed their minds and they were going to do a rock and roll show.
We had a whole stack of his albums, every movie he ever made, every recording he ever made, etc., which is how we basically tailor-made the show. What I told Elvis when he went to Hawaii is that we would make him a show that nobody else could do, only him. We would, like making a tailor-made suit, it would be made for him.
The day of the first taping, the Colonel had taken care of tickets, supposedly. He told Steve Binder, don't worry about it, I'll take care of this thing.
Right before we were going to go out there and put him in front of the audience, like maybe a couple of hours before, we found out that somebody had canceled the audience. The Colonel got on the phone and called up all the local DJs in LA and said, hey, get down to NBC. There's going to be an Elvis Presley live performance. And of course, they had four security guards. There was a riot, but they definitely got a bunch of people down there quick.
They also sent runners over to the Bob's Big Boy in the Valley, who went up and down the aisles begging people to leave their lunches and to go over to NBC to see this show. And every NBC exec who had a wife or a daughter called them on the phone and said, you have to get down to the studio today, get dressed up, you're gonna go to a concert.
Everybody was so shocked by seeing him in this new role of like, you know, a killer rock and roll singer again, you know, and the image of all those movies, even though we're still being played, I don't think still to this day is as strong as that single image of him looking in the camera at the beginning of that special and saying, if you're looking for trouble, you've come to the right place. If you're looking for trouble, look right in my face, you know, and then the camera pulls back and there's 100 people dressed as Elvis in the background. Fantastic.
And suddenly Elvis emerges, you know, head to toe in this black leather outfit. And he sort of, you know, reignited the flames again. It was like the old Elvis.
No man on earth ever looked as good as he did in 1968 in that black leather, and he sounded fantastic.
I thought that was when he looked his best as well. I mean, he was really a handsome, handsome guy at that period in his life.
He was awesome looking. I mean, I'm heterosexual, I'm straight as an arrow, and I gotta tell you, you stop, whether you're male or female, to look at him. He's that good looking.
Boy, he looked phenomenal, you know. I would have had his children.
I just sat down like a three-year-old. When I saw Elvis do his special, I just sat there mesmerized. I didn't get up, I didn't move. I was just, oh my God, it's never, you know, nothing ever changed. He always had that magic.
This was the first time he had performed in front of a live audience that wasn't paid, like in the movies, to just come out and perform.
When I looked at Elvis, I said, he's the one person that I could do the Napoleonic collar with it, because it'll frame his face, and like a lot of things that you do for women when you're designing their clothes, is to draw your attention to their face. And I thought, well, if I have the collar up there, people will notice his face.
This is quite an amazing thing, what happened to him. You know, he put on that black leather, you know, and the first time he had that black leather on, it was like, I think it was like a football player, when a football player puts on a uniform, you know. Now it's the duty. I've got to go out there and I've got to be me.
My favorite thing is him sitting around. I mean, as much as I love the dance numbers and love dancing, but him sitting around with the guys and doing that concert, to me, is a classic and will always be a classic.
Him and the guys, you know, up on that little stage, and without all the fanfare and the, you know, you really got a good shot at who Elvis was as a guy and who he was musically. It was terrific.
The brilliance of the idea of using his cronies or his old cronies from Memphis, his old musicians and friends from Memphis, was it naturally relaxed him totally, and so he was able to be very loose.
The first one or two tunes, if you've seen the film at all, you could tell he's a little nervous. He was a little bit shaky, scared. But then he got the kids were screaming and hollering and, you know, telling me he was fine. And you could hear him talking because he was sitting just within a few inches of all of them, you know. And after that, he just got relaxed and just done what he was supposed to do.
The sit-down portion in the circle, when they first did that, they had us out there by ourselves. And the fans were back about 30 yards there, or something like that. And Elvis was just talking softly, you know, said, man, I don't like this being this far from the audience. I said, well, it's your show. I asked them if they want to come down here. And Elvis stood up and said, y'all want to come sit down around here? And the director said, no, it was too late. They were all down there around there.
The sit-down part of it was originally, I believe, supposed to be about 10 minutes of the original show, and then now it became such a thing, it's its own special now, One Night With You, and that's the real Elvis.
I loved it because there again, it didn't separate Elvis from his fans. It was small, okay? It was, you know, even the guys off to the side and the audience was close, you know? It was like, hey, come on over to the house. And I'm going to entertain for you guys.
When he took the stage by himself, Elvis finally proved that he was no longer living in the shadow of who he once was. It had been nearly a decade since he had felt the excitement, the fear, the joy of standing on a stage and facing the audience literally one-on-one.
He was nervous, but it was not nervous scared, it was nervous energy, right? It was like Elvis energy, pent up for all these years. Here he was going to sing, you know, in front of an audience for the first time. And I don't think it was nerves. I think it was just sheer, unadulterated excitement and energy and nervous energy, but not, I'm scared to do this. It's, I want to do this.
When we first did the 68 comeback, we had the full orchestra and a choir in the same room. Elvis said, Charlie, I said, I can't read music. I don't know when to come in. I said, don't worry. I said, I'll tell Billy to turn to you when it's time to come in. And I said, after you do that a few times, you'll feel what it's nice to come in. And he, okay, he said, he trusted me on it. And I told Billy. And so when it come time for him to start singing on like the first thing, Billy turned to him like that. And after that, Elvis was home free.
I thought that was a great show. I thought it was a perfect show. I thought it was just a wonderful reintroduction of Elvis to the people. It was intimate. You know, and I assume he really had a good time doing that.
He really got what he had done, that he set the world back on its heels, that he changed fashion and sexual mores and music, you know, that he just kind of revolutionized all aspects of our culture when he came on the scene.
He moved like a sex machine. Those hips, the gyration of those hips, promised orgasm. Licentiousness and orgasm. Elvis, in a way, promised to all women in America a good orgasm. And he would deliver.
He seems to be the quintessential performer, and he's very enchanting. He just seems like he connects with the audience whenever he performs, and it's like he's singing directly to you. And he puts so much energy and feeling into every song that he sings. It's just, he's just an amazing performer. And it just really came across in 68.
I think and believe that what the live audience felt, television audience felt. That's why it was so special. There again, it's not putting that certain something in between the entertainer, star, superstar, and the audience fans.
I think he knew something great was happening for him. I mean, God knows he'd done so much, so many movies, and, you know, that it wasn't anything new for him, but it was different somehow. The Whorehouse number was unbelievable. The first version that went on the air, they didn't show that. They cut that out.
First thing was the Bordello sequence where he leaves his hometown and he goes, and the first encounter he has is he walks into a Bordello, and then there's this virgin, innocent girl who's never even worked one day, and she looks at Elvis and he looks at her, and just as they're about to get together, the place gets raided and they jump out the window and he's on the road again.
The 68 special, that was the second time I saw Elvis, and I don't know that he knew. I had just interviewed at NBC and got the part as the little virgin, the virgin girl of the night, I guess, to say it politely. I think it was little cameo shots that was going to be played in between the Bordello scene. And sure, we had fun. I remember we had some grapes, and he's a great tease, and he's fun to play with. I enjoyed it.
I really fell in love with him as a performer when I saw that. That was probably one of the all-time great specials, I think, ever.
He was like a caged tiger. He just ate the stage, he ate the audience, he ate everything, he ate the studio. It was unbelievable.
I like the raw energy in the 68 comeback, really. How it's really just him on the stage and everything, and you can really sense that he had a lot of pull on what he wanted to do for that show.
Not only had Elvis matured with time, his music had grown up as well. Along with playing all of his original hits, Elvis added a few new songs to his growing resume of stage favorites.
There was a chance for me to write one song for the
It was a, which everybody remembers, of course, the section where Elvis sat in his black leather outfit and sang the old hits from the Sundays. They asked me to write a song bookending that, you know, about looking back over the years. And I sat up that night at Billy Strange's house. Started writing about 6 o'clock in the evening, and 8 o'clock the next morning I had written Memories.
Well, you know, we wanted a closing song for the show, and we were looking at everything he'd done, and we couldn't find anything that really fitted the, you know, the way we wanted to express his feelings at the end of the show. And so we said to Earl Brown, who is our lyric writer, why don't you write a song for Elvis? And we said, Elvis, is that okay? And he says, yeah.
But I went home and something told me Elvis is not going to like what I'm going to write anyway. So I'll write something with Aretha Franklin in mind or somebody like that, and I'll write the music myself. So the next day I went in, we played the song for Bob Finkel and Steve Binger. And from the other room, I heard Colonel Parker's voice say, that ain't Elvis' kind of song. But behind me, I heard, I like to try it, man. And Elvis was behind me. I never knew he was there in the doorway listening to it. And from then on, it was like a universal movie of, you know, getting your song on Broadway or something.
Elvis startled everybody, by the way, during that number when it came down to laying down the tracks for If I Can Dream. Because he came into a recording studio and, you know, there's like an orchestra there and everything to accompany him. And he laid down on the floor and held the microphone and sang in a fetal position, kind of weeping as he sang.
Elvis was very emotional when he sang that song because he knew it was at the end of the show. And I got a sneaking suspicion he didn't want the show to end because he was having the best time of his life. And here was this big, powerful song, a big, powerful lyric about him.
Elvis had tasted greatness once again, but his televised special was only the start of his renaissance. The biggest comeback of his life lay just around the corner and 400 miles to the east.
What really inspired Elvis to go back on stage again is when we did the 68 special. You know, doing a little live performance in the improv section and getting the feel of fans and the audience. He was missing that.
I just missed it. I missed the closeness of an audience, of a live audience.
And then, as we all know, the Colonel was approached about playing Las Vegas at the International Hotel. And when the Colonel sat down with him and talked about doing that, I think he realized, hey, this is what I want to do. I want to go back to performing on stage, and that's what started. And from that time on, that's all we did.
He was so thrilled. He was like a little kid. He was just so, I'm going to play Vegas. You know, I mean, there was an innocence to him that was, I think that was part of his it, the thing that made him so charming. There was a vulnerability to him.
I remember Elvis being very, very nervous, and I remember thinking, gee, I hope he has a good crowd. Because, I mean, I knew he hadn't performed live on stage like that for a number of years, I think 10 years.
As I'm walking downstairs, having introduced him, he walks by me and says, are you nervous? I said, yeah. He says, I'm scared shitless.
He almost threw up every time they introduced him. But once he hit that spotlight, forget about it. He didn't stammer or stutter or anything. That voice would come out, a beautiful voice, you know. And he would get out there, and you knew by the look in his eyes that the fear was gone.
Well, I remember opening night in 1969 in Las Vegas at the International Hotel. Elvis was a nervous wreck. But when he walked out on that stage, and that audience jumped up, standing ovation, and he was just flying. I mean, you could tell he was nervous the first song, the second song, he got into it, and that was it. That show flew by.
I had a chance to see the first performance of Elvis in Las Vegas. That's when he had the karate outfit. And it was just such an exciting, his shows were always exciting, and they were spontaneous, and they were in the moment. And he sang great, and he had so much fun.
The excitement was unbelievable. Since the first day that he opened the door for Elvis Presley over there, there are people from all over the country. I had fans from Japan. They used to come over from Tokyo to Las Vegas, and so every performance since July 31st, 1969, until the last time he performed at the International.
I saw Elvis perform in Las Vegas on several occasions, including the big comeback, and before that, actually, from the first time he went to Vegas, I was there, and he was very exciting as a performer on stage. He had so much charisma, and he had a splendid instrument in his voice, and his feelings, and the way he would move, and he was just really exciting. I thought he was thrilling, really thrilling.
Elvis played two shows a night for 30 nights at the International Hotel before taking his show on the road. Next stop, the Houston Astrodome.
The attire is not one that we're familiar with seeing.
It was taken from a karate suit, just a regular karate type outfit. Are they coming to get me? Is that it?
Well, I think the most important thing is the inspiration that I got from a live audience. I was missing that.
It was difficult to play the Astrodome because it's just so big, you know. And they had us on a silly little flat trailer that they brought us out middle of the ring and around and finally to a stop.
We went into the Astrodome, and it was almost like a rehearsal show, because here we are out in the middle of the arena on this stage that keeps turning. And, you know, you'd say something, it would take, I think, 15, 20 seconds to get to the people, and then 15, 20 seconds for their response to get back to you. So the only thing you could do, just do straight through your show and don't stop.
I'd like to thank you very much. I'd like to tell you something else. This is the largest audience that I've ever sang to. So it makes one a wee bit nervous, I'll tell you.
Once we played Vegas and get a little test, a little short tour after Vegas with the Astrodome and a couple other cities, Elvis knew that's where he wanted to be. I mean, that's what Elvis loved to do more than anything in the world is perform live on stage. And that's how he started playing little clubs and little dates and stuff like that.
On the road, you're really performing for absolute diehard fans. Not that they weren't in Vegas, but it's a whole different thing.
As Elvis continued touring, he performed for each crowd as if it would be his last. He had become a polished and precise entertainer, making the audience part of the show.
He really was a student, though, of performing. He really was. I mean, I watched this growth, and I saw this getting the confidence. I saw him getting a better performer, playing with an audience.
He was very playful with the audience, and I think he really cared about his fans. He wanted to give them a good show.
I saw the audience going crazy. They waited in lines and they did. And I loved the way he played with people. He got to the point where he played with people and he got that wonderful feeling on stage.
He could play with the audience, which he liked to do, and they enjoyed it too. But he knew how far to push the audience as far as exciting them, before he'd do some humorous things like that to break it up. And he'd stop there. I mean, he was a master at that. My goodness. He just knew how to handle himself on stage. And He was always alert. He always walked sideways to the audience. That's in case somebody pulled him. He could use his leverage he had to not let him pull him into the audience.
Most of the time he'd sing what songs were in at that time. And as he got larger than that, he wouldn't sing as much. He'd talk a little more. He actually was funny a lot of times.
You ain't! We ain't! Y'all ain't!
He just didn't sing in every song in that. He would talk to the audience, communicate. He'd stroll up and down the stage.
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm event number 8.
Every performance was different. I never saw two alike.
Elvis never forgot the city that had welcomed him back with open arms at the beginning of his return. Las Vegas became his kingdom, and he would return there to perform as often as possible.
Audiences in Vegas they loved Elvis. They would get in line at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The show didn't start till 8, just because in those days there were not reserved seats. Now there are reserved seats. There'd be a line all the way through the casino, all the way out past the registration desk. The hotel couldn't believe it.
I took my parents and my family came to Vegas to visit, and we got a table and we got close down the front, and I saw him perform, and it was heavy, you know. It was great. I did see him perform. I'd seen him before that and after that. Did he do 2 or 3 shows in Vegas? And yeah, 2. And I went to both of them, and I got seats down in front. I used all the pull I had as a showgirl to get great seats.
Elvis filled the largest showroom we had by some. It was anywhere from about 700 seats larger than any other showroom. And he filled it consistently, 2 shows a night, 14 shows a week.
Everything about him was magic. When he was performing, he gave everything to the audience. And I think that people identified with his soul and the tenderness and the loving part of him.
He was the most adorable, endearing, vulnerable soul in many, many ways. And then to see him on stage, you saw this powerhouse, this dynamo, you know, this sexy, godlike being when his show was on.
February of 1970, we drove from Los Gatos all the way to Las Vegas, stayed in some cheap flop house motel, and went and saw Elvis for 1 show. That's all I could afford in those days. And didn't have the best seating. But when Elvis came out on stage, I was just mesmerized by his presence, his vocal singing ability, and just all these people in the showroom that came from all over the world just to see this one man entertain.
All excited, couldn't wait till he got on the stage. The music started playing, you got goosebumps and stuff, and I thought, wow, here he comes, and that music played, and he walked on that stage. It was the awesomest experience I ever had.
He had an edge to him that was dangerous in his performing. You could feel it. You know, just sparks would happen. It just dangerous.
Flabbergasted, jaw drop, hero, you know, all that stuff, all the above. You know, he was like nothing I'd ever seen before.
Elvis was in great shape. The first, second gig in Las Vegas, whatever that was, 72, 73, something like that. My God, the man's waist is like that. It's like, what? Was I jealous?
Because his live performances were, there's no words to describe them. And then his record performances were always so honest. And he used his voice like an instrument, and just like a musical instrument.
Oh, see, TC Ryder. Oh, see, what you have done.
Elvis had conquered the West Coast. Now it was time to reclaim the East, New York City.
I went to sleep one night, and I got up in the middle of the night, 3 o'clock in the morning. I was living in New York on 54th Street between 5th and 6th Avenue. And I got up and I said to my wife, I just had this crazy dream. I saw a sign in front of Madison Square Garden that said, Jerry Weintraub presents Elvis. I went to Elvis and I said, let's play New York City. And he said to me, I don't really want to go to New York City. I'm not a New York City kind of artist, you know. They're not going to like me in New York City. They like me in Alabama and Georgia and Tennessee, and but I don't want to go to New York City, Jerry. I said, Elvis, you're the biggest star in the world. They're going to not gonna like you. They're going to love you.
Elvis was a little concerned because New Yorks are famous for tough audiences, like, you know, and I remember Tom Hewlett and Jerry Weintraub saying, Elvis, don't worry about it. New York's going to love you. And he was concerned about it, you know. But then when they sold out five shows, he didn't know how he was going to be accepted, sold them out overnight, he was excited.
Man, I was tame compared to what they do now. Are you kidding? I didn't do anything. We just jiggle, you know.
Madison Square Garden. When he came out, there were so many flashbulbs went off that the arena, there was moments when the arena was lit. And we come out in a blackout.
They came and slept outside Madison Square Garden for 2 weeks to get tickets. It was absolutely amazing.
For the next leg of his tour, Elvis helped design an expensive new series of jumpsuits based on 19th century Victorian fashions that he'd seen in a book. They became his trademark throughout the 1970s.
When he appeared on the stage in those magnificent outfits, it was extraordinary.
Elvis wore, no matter how much it was, he always found a way to wear the coolest outfits, back then the flashiest.
And we found that the color that worked the best was white. It allowed them to change the colors on him, whereas black would absorb all the color, and it was hard to highlight him. And we experimented with blue, which was one of his favorite colors, red, but it just ended up the white was the best thing.
I remember he was asking my mom, he did one of his take my mom into the back room things and ask her, what color do you think I ought to wear? Because he had all these different outfits, different colors. He asked my mother, what do you think? And she said, I think you look better in the white. And I remember the next show he had white on. And he did. He looked awesome in the white jumpsuit.
You know, if you look at my early pictures performing on stage in Vegas, you'll see I've got on one of those Bill Ballou suits with the sequins and stuff. Of course, it was never as nice as Elvis's because Bill Ballou had lost his gig if he'd have made me one as nice as Elvis's.
The last thing I was working on, and we had actually done a prototype of it, it was called a laser suit. And what we did, there were certain points, and it had very large stones that would tell him where he could puncture himself, and that's where the laser would shoot. And we had these strategically placed on the suit, and as I say, you know, whenever he would touch himself, then the laser beams would shoot out.
Sadly, the laser suit never panned out, but Elvis continued on with his tour, playing to sold-out arenas and stadiums across the United States.
Well, Elvis played to audiences no matter what, big or small. He didn't care if it was Vegas, and any entertainer that's a performer in front of a live audience would tell you there's nothing, no feeling in the world like it, and Elvis has said it many times. You feel the love from the audience, you feel electricity, it makes you come alive, and that's why he said that's his favorite thing to do, and that's why he would always do it.
A live concert, to me, is exciting because of all the electricity that's generated in the crowd and on stage.
And you'd see this mass of people. And you would look as far as your eye could see, and then you couldn't see anything anymore. And you knew that there was just still people out there. And you'd watch him, knowing that you knew him, and watch this human being on stage, and then watch the people. And I can't even describe the feeling.
Mostly Las Vegas, I would go twice a year, January, February, and August and September. So that started in 1970 through 76. The last three shows I saw there in December. And then I would go to Lake Tahoe when he'd be there at the Sahara Tahoe. I also saw him at the Oakland Coliseum and the San Francisco Cow Palace.
The reason for the first scarf was Elvis working where he did, perspiration would run down into his eyes. And after a lot of shows, after so much perspiration, his eyes would be so red, you know, and Joe and guys, I kept put eye drops in there, cause him to stop on his body. So he got the scarf just so he could, you know, get some of the sweat off and out of his eyes and everything. And this went along, and everything's working fine. And one night, somebody asked for the scarf. So he gave it to her. And the next night, he said, Charlie, you better bring up another scarf in case somebody else wants one. So he brought up another scarf to lay on the piano. And it escalated.
Elvis would be singing and stuff. And then the Hilton, they had long tables, and they sat you in rows. And there'd be your cocktails, serve cocktails and stuff. And girls would take their shoes off and walk on that stage, knocking the glasses over to get up to Elvis. You know, not just hundreds of them, but a few would get that. And he'd tell them, no, now you can't do that. You're going to hurt yourself. He'd usually give them a scarf and try to get them down. And that happened a lot of times.
But it was almost as if he was like blessing each person. You know, he'd take the scarf off, wrap around their neck, kiss them.
When we'd go on tour, a lot of times Elvis and the Colonel, we'd be down at the end of a big arena and no one could see behind, from behind like that. And the Colonel and them would buy those seats and give it to a home, you know, for somebody. A group of people that were able to come in and they could sit back there. It wouldn't cost them anything. They could hear Elvis and everything. And Elvis goes back there, and he throws up his scarf. It just comes floating down. And he throws it up again. It just comes floating down. So he went around to the other side. Meanwhile, Joe called me over to the side and told me what it was. So I went back over, and he did it a couple times over there. And then he turned around and started back out way. And I said, Elvis. And he leaned over, because I didn't say Elvis. He could tell I was going to tell him something. So he leaned over, and I said, it's the home for the blind. He said, whew. I thought I'd lost it.
By the early 70s, Elvis had achieved the rank of 8th-degree black belt in karate, and his surreal punches and wild kicks became as much a part of his concert performances as his jumpsuits.
After 16 years of doing this art every day for 16 years, I was awarded the 8th degree, which carries, let's see, 8th degree. There's only 10 degrees of black. So the 8th degree I just got this week, the 9th degree carries senior master of the art, the next one, and the 10th is senior grand master of the art. So that's where I got to strive to go to, which takes quite a while, isn't it?
What do you do for relaxation? You said you study
karate. If you can relax doing this, I don't know.
Elvis asked me how I liked the show, and I said, in particular, I really like when you finish Kentucky Rain and you do that karate stuff. It sure is fun to watch.
And he'd go into his kind of karate mode, you know, and he would go, up and down his body, missing him by little, and never touched him.
Elvis drops down on the floor and starts doing these maneuvers, these exercises, and go, and the legs were flying, and you know, he was in such great shape. He was agile, like a gymnast.
One time, he was singing and doing some of his karate moves, and he goes, oh no, and he ripped his pants all in the back. So he just didn't leave the stage. They brought the curtain around him and went and got him a pair of pants.
And Richard put another pair of pants and zipped it up, and he walked back out. But that necessitated the jumpsuits that would stretch. And started that really great look, man. I always thought that Elvis is the only one who could dress like that.
When we went to Vegas, I contacted Ice Capades, and I talked to some friends of mine there, and I said, you know, would y'all be interested in making Elvis Presley's clothes for Vegas? Because I would like to use what is known for ice skaters as stretch gab, or gabardine. And it allows skaters to do their splits, their turns, and everything. And I thought it would be great for Elvis, because the one thing he said that he wanted to incorporate in his act was his karate.
On January 14th, 1973, Elvis finally reached the pinnacle of his mighty comeback. He played in front of the entire world. His live concert, Elvis Aloha from Hawaii, beamed via satellite to an audience of 1 billion people in 40 countries around the world.
Comprehend it, because in 15 years it's hard to comprehend that happening. All the countries all over the world via satellite, it's very difficult to comprehend. But it's my favorite part of the business, is a live concert.
How do you pace yourself?
I exercise every day, I vocalize every day, I practice if I'm working or not.
No. In the Aloha from Hawaii, you know, no one had ever done anything like that before. More people watched the Aloha concert than watched Neil Armstrong walk on the moon.
He wanted to tour the world, but he couldn't do it. And so the next best thing, to do a live show where they could see him live.
He looked absolutely stunning on that show. He was down to a good weight. He was down to the weight that he was when I first met him in 1969.
When I saw Elvis on stage, yeah, it was the same man I knew in private at moments, you know, and no, it was like, wow, where'd that come from?
When you saw Elvis, he was mesmerizing. He just, you didn't want to blink because you might miss something, and it was just incredible.
They had 67% of all of the TVs in Japan tuned in to that show, and almost the same amount on the rerun a few months later.
That's where Elvis and Jack Lord became good friends. And everything comes was the night of the actual film, Jack Lord was there. And one of the greatest compliments another actor gave another actor in stage work is to stand up and whistle real loud like that. They said at the end of that show, Jack Lord was standing on his chair, whistling, you know, and said, get up, get, and everybody was standing up giving Elvis an ovation.
There's no way that I could explain the joy that it was to be on the stage with 25 and in Hawaii 50,000 people screaming and hollering. Elvis always said the show is in the audience, not on the stage. One time he when they were screaming so much, as they always did, he said, he told us before he did it, he said, I think I'll take my coat off and throw it out in the audience. And he did. And they tore that coat. It was like throwing a pound of meat out to a bunch of hungry dogs. They tore that coat into a jillion pieces.
After all was said and done, Elvis left Hawaii $1 million richer and 1 billion fans stronger. He finished out 1973 by touring from Arizona to Georgia, his fan base growing larger and more intimate every day.
The feelings that he created between him and the public and his fans, fans that were crazy about, you know, out of their mind about this man, to see him, to touch him, to be close to him. No performance, no entertainer ever created that feeling. And I worked with Sinatra, I worked with Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis, I worked with Perry Como, I worked with the big female stars, Lena Horne, even the Jackson Brothers when they were together. Nobody ever created that feeling that I know that was between the fans and Elvis Presley.
But then there was this time he really did forget the words. The bridge over Treble Water.
And
you know,
I have a tape of it.
And
too.
She's got it. And he came right over
give me a word,
to
give
us
me a
and
word.
He went,
Give me a word.
What's next? Well, we started singing it. Like a bridge over Treble Water. And then the table
started singing.
And then the next table.
And then half and then the hall was singing. And officers stood there
he
like
just stood
this.
There.
And then the other half started applauding. Applauding like this. And Elvis just stood there and he said, "That's right." He said, "You are.
You did good.
You did good." And then he started up again.
Well, Elvis loved his audience. You could tell it was like a romance. You know, when he got on the stage, he seemed to just, he could relate to them. And that's why people loved him. He just could relate. It was like a love affair between him and the audience.
And he was only one of the most talented entertainers on this earth. God, he was so gifted, his voice. Oh, God blessed him. When someone's that good, you know, they can sing that well, you can't take that away from them. He'll go on for generations and generations.
You'd catch his eye or he would take a look or something. It was very, very personal, and that generosity was given to the audience. He had that generosity, and he gave everything that he had. He did not hold back anything.
It was the greatest comeback of all time, a comeback that lasted nearly 9 years. Elvis had resurrected his career by returning to what he loved most, the music.